Christmas.
I don't know why you like that hat. You get it, go ahead.
This would be a working lunch, I mean, we'd be able to talk and everybody's permitted to talk with their mouth full. But it's a welcome here to Dick Thornburg, Nick Brady, Larry Cavazos, new members of our circle, and delighted to have you here. And there's an empty chair down there that when it comes, it'll be for Jim Miller and we'll say goodbye to him, but he'll be leaving us. And before I get into anything, I just wonder if I could take a minute to read something to you here in case you haven't seen it. This has to do with some statements made by Mr. Dukakis. Statement, you can borrow and spend and borrow and spend and borrow and spend only so long. Massachusetts, this is not, that's the end of the quote. Massachusetts state spending has risen 61.7% since he returned to office in 1983. That's more than double the rate of increase in federal spending during the same period. In his 1989 budget, state debt is projected at more than $10 billion, double the 1983 debt. In June of 86, Massachusetts had a cash surplus of $912 million. In June of 1988, the governor had to borrow $300 million to meet the payroll. And since then, the state has had to borrow $600 million more. Dukakis, I'm not surprised by the comeback in manufacturing. I'd like to enlarge and stimulate it. End quote. Massachusetts has lost more than 90,000 industrial jobs since 1984, a decline of 13%, while the number of industrial jobs nationally grew by 2% during the same period. Massachusetts ranks 33rd in job growth since 1981. Quote, we've got to get interest rates down, end quote. The average annual prime rate has dropped from 18.9% in 1981 to 8.2% in 1987. Under Carter, the prime rate rose each year, hitting 21.5% in December of 1980. Quote, we're not going to accept an America where all we do is take in each other's laundry and flip each other's hamburgers for $3.35 an hour, end quote. More than 70% of the jobs created since the end of the recession pay more than $375 a week, $10.70 an hour. Nearly one-third of the jobs created since 82 are in the managerial and professional categories. Quote, exchange voodoo economics for can-do economics, end quote. The federal deficit fell by more than $70 billion between 86 and 87, while the top tax rate was cut from 50% to 28%. Massachusetts, meanwhile, has just retroactively balanced a fiscal 1988 budget in which expenditures outpaced revenues by $590 million. The Bank of Boston forecasts a deficit as high as $690 million for 1989, despite the enactment of more than $300 million in additional state taxes and fees. I just thought the conversation might
be say that. If anybody wants a copy of that.
Yes, we have
you have copies. We have
copies. Kranowitz on what's happening up on the Hill, what ain't going to happen. Take it away, Alan.
Mr. Chairman, having said that, of course, we do recognize that there is a need to get some more funds into the fund. Others have been speaking out fairly regularly to get some of that money appropriated.
Your interruption is welcome in this case. Ladies and gentlemen, the real drug czar.
We have to wait for a moment here, and a couple of waves of press are going to come in. The first wave will just sit here. As the man said at the Last Supper, all who want to get in the picture, get on your side of the
table.
pleased that we were to have everybody on board for the ethics process. Of your priority, my priority.
There'll be another wave coming in. They will be the talking press.
President, what do you hear about the hostages?
Actually, we have no word on that, and we're still waiting to get some confirmation on all the things that have been said, but as far as we know, no hostage has been released yet.
Do you expect it to happen today?
It's hard to tell with the what little information we have. But now, I don't have to tell anyone here that every family in America has a stake in what all of you on this board, what you do. You're the command team for our fight against drugs. And this is Dick Thornburg's first meeting, so Dick, welcome aboard. You have my full confidence, and with Dr. Bowen at your side and the other members of this board, the fight against drugs couldn't be in better hands. The time remaining in our administration is short, but the work before us is great. I expect this board to redouble its commitment to the vital work of achieving a drug-free America. And this is another in which I want to sprint to the finish line, no letting up. Drive as hard as you can. This administration has no more solemn commitment than the one it has made to families across our land to fight drugs. I wish I could say the same for Congress. But when it comes to fighting drugs, Congress looks more and more like all talk and no action. They've cut funding for the major agencies that enforce our drug laws, and liberals in the Senate are trying to kill the House-passed drug bill. And that bill provides a federal death penalty for drug-related killings, a modification of the exclusionary rule so that relevant evidence obtained in good faith can be used in court, and other needed changes in the law. It's time for Congress to end its dependency on the liberal agenda and to give our law enforcement officers the tools they need. And it's time for the Senate to pass a strong drug bill. In conclusion, let me say that this board, believe me, you have my fullest confidence. And you have a great responsibility, but you're equal to it. So, Dick, good luck.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Will you sign the bill if it doesn't include the death penalty?
Well, Helen, as you know, I won't talk about a bill until it's on my desk and I know what's in it.
Well, that's not always.
Well, no, because that's sometimes that they just make one so objectionable that I know in advance.
Chairman Annunzio, who did this for us.
Mr. President, Bill Goodland.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Fine, thank you. Have a nice day.
Hello, Mr. President. I'm Congressman Pat Roberts, and I represent Appleton and Abilene in my district. Okay, thank you, sir.
Ed McCabe, nice to be with you again. Well, great to be here. Thank you so much for having us.
President General Goodmaster.
Yeah, it's so good to see you again.
Yes, indeed.
George York and a lifetime friend of the Eisenhower family. I recognize the honor of yours, Mr. President.
Mr. President, John Whitney, the Eisenhower Library. Nice to see you, sir.
Nice to see you.
Mr. President, Brad Patterson, the Executive Director of the Commission. Pleasure to meet you, sir.
Pleased to see you.
I get $10. I checked one on the first time.
He got it back.
Can everybody turn slightly sideways?
Okay,
just grab
the room.
Still's
in
here.
Still.
All right. I guess we have to wait for that. Well, it's a pleasure to welcome all of you to the Oval Office and sign this bill that marks the 100th birthday of President Dwight David Eisenhower. Favorite son of Kansas and adopted son of Pennsylvania, he not only was a great soldier, but he was an eminent statesman. President of the United States and devoted his life to service of his country. His career was marked by an unshakable commitment to human freedom. And this coin that will be brought about when I sign this is a tribute to his memory, and I'm pleased that you could all be with me here today as I sign this legislation. Since having said that, I think I'd better sign. Approach pattern. Yes, Mr. Prime Minister.
So glad to see you again.
Well, it's good to see you again.
Really
good. Good to see you.
Great to see you.
Ambassador Johnson.
Mr. President, yes, hello. Greetings.
Well,
delighted to see you once again.
Good to see you. Thank you for what you're doing.
Thank you, sir.
Hi.
Well, Kelly Abrams, our ambassador, you know.
Yes.
How are you, Mr. President? Good to see you again.
Good to see you. Right, shall we do
it? I'm nice to see you again. How are you?
Hello, are you a good friend?
I am.
Hi. You'll have to be quiet for a moment or two while two ways. You're my first official visitor when I came into office several years ago, and now here we are with the curtain going down on my administration. Here again, very pleased to see you.
Well, in more ways than one, I'm happy to have the opportunity of seeing you before you came into office, having had the opportunity to have been the first head of government to visit you. But I'm really here to take advantage of my visit here in Washington. So thank you so much for the assistance that you've given me.
I get rid of the press and talk a moment about it.
Japanese cameras.
Mr. President, have you heard anything further about this prospective hostage release?
No, we don't have any current information. Apparently that has not taken place. That's all we know, and whether it's going to take place later in the day or not, we have no way of knowing.
Are you optimistic?
Well, I try to be. The first information sounded as if it was based on fact.
Mr. President, have you received any indication as to what this means for U.S. relations with Iran, the situation in Lebanon? Is this tied in any way to any kind of political, diplomatic overture?
Well, no, not on the basis of any negotiations of any kind. We have done nothing of that kind.
Is there any reason to think that it's some kind of overture from Iran for better relations?
Again, I can't comment. We just don't have enough information.
Lights, please. Thank you.
There's been a report.
Thank you.
This way, please.
This way, please. Thank you.
You're right.
Thank you.